Give me la dolce vita, hot music.
I'm Jimmy Petterson, born in the United States, resident of Austria, citizen of the world. BA in history, master's in education, followed by more than 40 years of ski bumming, street music, and travel. But hey, Dad, don't fret about my poor resume. I've met many people, made a lot of friends, skied more than 4,000 days on all seven continents, and I've come away with quite a few interesting stories to tell.
I'm traveling free. I wanna travel free.
This is a story about kindness, generosity, hospitality, and even a little bit about skiing. It's about how friendships are made across cyberspace and international borders, and how mountains are a wonderful cement that bond people together.
Oh, thank you. Thank you very much.
Very much, very much.
The principal characters in the tale, besides myself, are Daniel Brees, a Swedish outdoorsman and videographer who traveled with me from Europe to Tajikistan, Nikita, a Russian who's worked as an engineer on the Rogun Dam project since 2009, his wife Audrey, a French woman who teaches her native language at the delegation of the European Union in Dushanbe, Martin Rossmann, an Austrian working for an NGO in Dushanbe, and Denis Dmitriev, a Tajik snowboard enthusiast. The latter four, all strangers, had all agreed to help me organize a trip to ski in my 74th country. Tajikistan is a country full of spectacular mountains. Many of them are covered by ice and snow the year round, for the country is home to the mighty Pamirs, a range that reaches the lofty height of 7,500 meters. While snow and mountains are necessary for alpine skiing, they're not the only prerequisites. And the Pamirs are not very accessible unless you happen to have a helicopter at your disposal. We did not. Our plan was to ski at lower elevations, mountains that are closer to the capital city of Dushanbe and that are reachable by road. That might sound simple, but in Tajikistan, nothing is really that easy. Tajikistan is an extremely poor country. According to the CIA, their per capita GDP of $3,000 per year puts them in 193rd place among 230 nations. To give you a better idea, they are poorer than Papua New Guinea, $3,500, or Sudan, $4,500. Poverty is somewhat more palatable in a warm climate country, but if one combines poor with cold and mountainous, the effects of the poverty are multiplied. One area where one can easily feel those effects is in the transportation infrastructure. The roads are more like a long line of connected potholes, and a four-wheel drive vehicle is a necessary minimum to get around even in the lower mountains near the capital. All our friends, however, had SUVs, and they were willing to transport us and guide us around their mountainous homeland. One aspect of skiing that is never in our control, regardless of whether the country is rich or poor, is the weather. And the weather gods seem to be aligned against us. Our arrival met with a barrage of rain and wet, heavy snow. Even in the best of weather, travel in third world countries rarely goes according to the plan. On our second day, Dennis picked us up with his fancy SUV to take us to a location for making a ski tour. We were to skin up the mountain for some hours and then ski back down. Things went awry from the start. To begin with, Dennis's fancy vehicle still was no match for the weather and conditions. The snow on the road was so deep that we got stuck. It took an hour and the help of a handful of locals to get us out. Not only had we lost an hour, but we would have to begin our trek at a lower elevation than planned. Perhaps horseback might have been a better means of transportation. I suppose we were jousting against windmills to even contemplate a ski tour in such conditions. But after all, when one has traveled a great distance, one does not give up so easily. We trudged upward in the fog, rain, and sleet for close to 2 hours, until we were drenched to the bone through all layers of clothing. Fortunately, Dennis knew of a meteorology station not too far off, where he suggested that we might be able to take refuge. A short time later, a very primitive dwelling came into view, but in my cold and wet circumstance, it looked like an oasis in the desert.
Oh man, sopping wet to the bone. I feel and look like something the cat dragged in. I thought this was gonna be a day for skiing my 73rd country, but so far we've just been transporting ourselves on skis. So I think we might have to wait till tomorrow for proper skiing.
The angel of mercy who came to our assistance was Natalia, a middle-aged woman who for years had occupied this lonely outpost by herself. She welcomed us into her humble abode, put some more wood on the fire, and immediately went out to prepare us a warm meal.
دخترکای خر میره خالکی سومش هست پر دخترکای خر میره کبکای داری ره
Good food.
Thank you.
On an ordinary day, when she didn't save strangers from the elements, she carefully wrote her meteorological statistics into her notebook and then sent them on by SMS to some higher authority. This was her life. We dried out as best we could for a couple of hours, and we bid our savior a fond farewell.
She's happy. I give her another hug. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Then, like a horse that can smell the stable, we headed as quickly as possible back in the direction of our car. Our first attempt at skiing Tajikistan really ended up being no more than an exercise in cross-country skiing. The day was not a complete loss. Not only had we met with Natalia's warm-hearted hospitality, but close to the car we met some friendly local villagers. I had to do something to change the mood. I was beginning to realize that our trip might be more about people and culture than about skiing.
I saw you, heard you once. Me, I just had.
Ultimately, we drove to Rogun and met the last of our local team, Nikita. Nikita is not Tajik, he's Russian. In true Russian style, our dinner was accompanied by a bottle of vodka, in this case, homemade.
40% like vodka?
Yes, maybe a bit more, because it's not very important, but how to say, I have a bottle of vodka at home all the time.
You sound very Russian to me. Maybe. Yeah.
By the time we had polished off the moonshine, we slept like babies. Nikita had planned to take us on a ski tour near his home, but the rain continued to fall the following morning. So with much disappointment, Nikita had to cancel our second ski day. A bit of doubt about reaching my goal of skiing my 74th country began to creep into my mind. With poor weather and sloppy snow, the only solution was to ski the prepared piste at the actual resort of Safed Dara. The distance was not that far, but with the condition of the Tajik roads, Dennis began what would be almost a full day of driving. We passed through the village of Takob and another village as well. Muddy roads, primitive homes with outhouses, lots of snow, and some cars that had clearly been snowbound since the onset of winter. At long last, we arrived in Safed Dara. The ski resort had in the previous year been the beneficiary of a major renovation. The old T-bar had been replaced by a brand new Doppelmayr gondola, and the Soviet-era hotel had undergone a complete facelift.
We're at the hotel at the base of the Safed Dara ski resort. This was originally an old Soviet-era hotel built in the mid-70s as a youth sports center. And as part of this major renovation project in 2016, it got a whole facelift.
The renovated hotel looked good, but Dennis usually rented a room from a local family in the village of Rogbolo, a couple of kilometers from the resort and a 10-minute walk up a snow-covered trail from the road. Some local boys helped me with my gear. We were shown to a simple room with carpets on the floor, but no furniture. The woman of the house, Zainab, lit a fire in the wood-burning stove the moment we arrived. No sooner had we sat down on the floor, and a parade of food began appearing. Soup, galama, the local bread, cookies, nuts, raisins, chocolates, and of course tea. There is always lots of tea. When we absolutely could eat no more, we were invited into their living room. Now more of the same sort of food was brought in. Our host family, Zainab and her husband Holmirad, were there along with the rest of the family and quite a few neighbors as well.
My daddy was a family base man, my mama in the naval reserve. When I was young, I carried a gun, but I never got the chance to serve. I did not serve.
The following morning, when it came time to pay for our visit, our host refused payment. A thought struck me. I remembered back to a recent visit in Turkey. Mountain people in any given country have more in common with mountain people in a different and faraway land than they have with city dwellers in their own country. The various mountain people share a similarly harsh life with few amenities and a long and tiresome workday. But there are positive similarities as well. The communities are small and everybody knows one another. As a result, people trust and help their neighbors. With an awareness of the uncompromising nature of the environment, mountain people are generally hospitable to strangers as well. They invite you into their home out of the cold, for there is no hotel, bar, or restaurant in their little community for you to seek refuge. The openness is quite different from life in an urban environment where many people live in large apartment blocks and one usually does not know most of one's neighbors. Hence, the atmosphere is not friendly and trusting of neighbors or strangers. In recent times, the commonality among mountain people has begun to change. In wealthy countries like Austria, as many mountain people have shifted from an agrarian economy to one based on tourism, they no longer give away favors for free, because their livelihood now depends upon getting paid for such services. Meanwhile, mountain existence in poor nations like Tajikistan continues to be characterized by the same harsh, isolated conditions as in the past, and by the same traditional warm hospitality. That natural human inclination to love thy neighbor and share whatever little one might have with him is alive and well in Tajikistan, and it was truly a privilege to experience it. Dennis had to depart, but our Austrian connection, Martin, had driven up in the morning to ski with Daniel and myself. We arrived at the lift, but there was no movement. Something was clearly amiss. We were told that there was some sort of electrical problem. At the resort, we met Farkod and his wife, Sano. They drove a big, shiny SUV, and they were geared up with all the latest equipment. They were clearly not your average Tajik riders.
We are local. Hello, guys. We are from Tajikistan, and we like this place. And we are here till, let's say, 5 or 6 years. We are coming here, let's say, every week. And because we like skiing, she is a ski, I am a snowboarder rider. And we like this place.
They recently had a Red Bull kind of competition here.
And yeah, the last year it was competition, the Red Bull competition, and she is a champion by skiing. And I've been the first place by snowboarder.
Yeah.
Let's say if you will come here on Sunday and Saturday, here is full of people, no place on hotel, you know, it's a lot of people. Mm-hmm. But for the, let's say, middle week days, it's not a lot of people who will come because everybody's working.
Yeah.
There were only a handful of other skiers on the mountain that day, and the rest did not look like members of the upper class. A few were practicing in the relative flat, walking up a ways and attempting to glide back down. One man wore blue jeans, skinny skis, and purple and yellow ski boots, vintage 1985. The ski area, however, had a solution. It was midweek and there were very few visitors. Hence, the personnel would drive us up the mountain in snowmobiles for the same price as they would ordinarily charge to ride the lift, €4 a ride. It seemed that I was going to be able to ski my 74th country after all. Farkod, Sana, and I decided to take a run together. It was when I first saw Sano ski that the penny dropped, and I really began to see the light. She was perhaps a bit beyond a snowplow, but her technique was rather lacking considering her husband had just bragged about her being the female champion of the country. In skiing terms, Tajikistan was Japan circa 1925. We had planned to ski another day, but when we phoned to Safed Dara the next time, the lift was closed, this time on account of the weather. In Tajikistan, there's one sport that definitely will not be canceled on account of weather. It was still snowing as Martin, Nikita, and Audrey accompanied Daniel and myself south of Dushanbe on our final day to see a buzkashi match.
The snowy weather and the bad snow have been a real hindrance to our skiing in Tajikistan, but at least come rain or shine or snow, we have our first buzkashi match behind me. This is an amazing game in Central Asia. It was originally imported from Mongolia and China probably sometime at least 500 years ago. And it is still played in most of Central Asia. They're on horseback. They have a dead goat that they have to try to grab from the ground while on horseback and bring to the goal to win prizes. Here in Tajikistan, it's played as an individual sport where anybody can win the prize. It is not a team sport.
The sport can best be described as organized chaos, with emphasis on the chaos and very little that is organized. One could hardly imagine a more dangerous sport. And while it certainly is more dangerous for the players, the spectators are also not without risk. Imagine trying to watch a cattle stampede at close range, and you'll get the picture. Would you want a front row seat for the running of the bulls? To put it into skiing terminology, picture a Chinese downhill on the Hanankam with hundreds of spectators on the course. The game is played in a relatively flat area surrounded by some low hills, but there's no perimeter to the so-called field, and the horsemen can end up galloping directly into a large group of spectators who have to run for their lives to avoid being trampled. Local men gathered from far and wide long before the match began. There was not a woman in sight. Soon an old truck drove up, and on the back were two decapitated goats. Also on board were six live goats, a cow, and a number of carpets, apparently all prizes for each and every horseman who succeeded to score a goal. For the next few hours, it was pure pandemonium. The game was still in full swing when we headed back toward Dushanbe after about 3 hours of the spectacle, and none of us had a clue if any goals had been scored. That mattered little. We didn't have a wager on the game, after all. We were merely absorbing culture. In the end, culture is really what this trip was about. It was about Western snow sports culture meeting Central Asian buzkashi culture. And it was about simple, primitive mountain culture, a culture where, if still found in its pure state, void of tourism, is as open, friendly, and hospitable as any culture in the world. It's human nature to be friendly and hospitable to our fellow human beings. People who are born and raised in poor and isolated villages, where neighbors must help one another to survive, learn early on to be kind and generous. And they carry that trait with them into old age. My heartfelt thanks go out to Nikita, Audrey, Martin, and Dennis, who reached across cyberspace to welcome two strangers to their country. Equal thanks go out to Natalia and the meteorological station, Zineb and Holmirod, with whom we stayed in Rogbolo, and a number of other kind people who treated us with warm mountain friendliness and generosity, reminding us that kindness has no economic prerequisites and that human nature is intrinsically good.
Take me home to the place I belong, West Virginia, mountain mama. Take me home, country road.
Give me la traveling free. I'm traveling free.